So good morning and welcome to this very important conversation about water in San Antonio. This conversation could be taking place anywhere, practically in America, but certainly in Texas where drought seems to be just hanging on, it is important to our community to talk about it. And it's important for this, any city in America, to be talking about it because they all need abundant and fresh supply of waters. In fact, there are some cities that they predict will probably lose population as they lose water. So that's why the UTSA College of Public Policy has invited you today to learn more about the proposed Vista Ridge pipeline project and its impact on San Antonio. I'd like to thank the San Antonio Water System for their participation in this program, in addition to hosting a series of public events about water source. UTSA has got a partnership that goes way back, and I see some of our good friends here in terms of Mr. Puente and Berto Guerra and Reed Williams, whom we have known for many years. It's great to be in the same room with you all. You have been supporting us for quite a while. Many of you know UTSA students are very talented and they get hired by SAWS. You're an active supporter in our pre-freshman engineering program, which we are proud of that. You continue to advise us on establishing our Water Institute of Texas that we have on our campus. We wouldn't be able to turn on the fountain without your assistance in helping us use condensed water and not fresh water. We got a prize from you all, the top prize in water conservation. We're proud to receive that. And we got it because we are able to move in areas that are saving us water. For example, we now have AstroTurf, artificial turf on our recreational playing fields. This is a savings of 14.5 million gallons of water per year. So you can imagine if 10 acres is using 14 million acres of water a year, you can sense as to why this is a great savings. By the way, it costs us $7 million to put those AstroTurfs in, but it'll pay off in the long run. We've also had, in terms of our new dorms, we have about 2,000 new dorms. 200, the last batch of new dorms have the high efficiency toilets and shower heads to aid in the campus water savings. We continue to recycle condensed water from applied engineering building. And lots of things going on in xeriscaping and converting our irrigation system to high efficiency. So we have exciting things happening every day in terms of water conservation. So, and thank you, SAWS, for recognizing these initiatives, and proud to say that we're doing our part. So it's not a surprise to me that the Reed Williams and I were talking about how we got our engineering folks engaged in this. He said, it's going to take more than engineers. It's going to take the economists. It's going to take the public policy people. And he's right. This is not going to be, this is too complex, too big, too burdensome an issue to be resolved by any one group. And so we, in fact, have our public policy folks in talking about the proposed Vista Ridge pipeline. And as I mentioned, it's a series of communities that we get a sense that this conversation is extremely important to this community and others. So let me thank the UTSA and SAW staff who made this event possible, Aaron Gines and from the UTSA College of Public Policy, and Mario Aguilar and Selena Alvarez from SAWS, among the many people who really deserve some credit. And again, it's going to be a great conversation. Thank you all for being here.
Now it is my pleasure to introduce us to the next speaker, which is our mayor, Ivy Taylor. And I am very pleased that Ivy is a member of our faculty in the College of Public Policy. She teaches in the Department of Public Administration and has been an excellent instructor for our students and the vision that she provides and the insights regarding public service. The mayor has been in her job, and I can say a very short period of time, but is already doing a lot of work and thinking ahead and trying to move our city forward in the next several months. So with that, please help me welcome Mayor Ivy Taylor.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone.
Morning.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sines, and I also offer a warm welcome to everyone that's gathered here today for what I know will be a great public discussion about San Antonio's water future. Thank you to my friends and family at the UTSA College of Public Policy for taking a lead role in ensuring that our community has the information it needs in order to make informed decisions about the direction that we'll take on the Vista Ridge Pipeline Project. As you know, I have focused on a comprehensive planning path in my new role as mayor of San Antonio that will include a bottom-up approach driven by our citizens. So it's appropriate that the public is gaining insight today on San Antonio Water Systems' plans for sustainable and affordable water supplies for our future. SAW's planning process has been open and transparent, including public negotiations on a contract for Vista Ridge and events like this one here in partnership with the UTSA College of Public Policy. I know that SAWS will continue vigorous public outreach efforts, which will be needed. We are, the SAWS water management plan includes investments in desalination, the Regional Carrizo Aquifer Project, and the aquifer storage and recovery facility. We're currently weathering a serious drought, but due to our investment in a diverse and renewable supplies, which are critical to the quality of life and economic development, we're able to weather the storm. At a time when we're facing historic cuts to our supply from the Edwards Aquifer, it's even more critical that we closely examine diverse water supply options, not only for the benefit of our city, but for the benefit of our region. The more diversified we can become, the better off the Edwards Aquifer will be, and the better off our region will be. That's already been demonstrated with the non-Edwards supplies that we utilize in San Antonio to meet local demand. And I would also just pause to thank those of you in the room that have been actively engaged and involved on this issue over many years. We appreciate your engagement and your continued involvement in this key issue for our city. So I know that you're eager to better understand the Vista Ridge Pipeline proposal and what it could mean for San Antonio's future and the health of our region. So we look forward to a vigorous discussion from the esteemed panel today. Thank you again for your participation and for supporting the UTSA College of Public Policy Scholarship Fund and SAW's Payment Assistance Program. Thank you.
Thank you again for attending this excellent and important event. I'm just going to say a few words about the College of Public Policy that we're co-sponsoring this event. The College of Public Policy is located here in our UTSA beautiful downtown campus. There are a few things of pride that I point out about our college, and good thing that Greg gave me 45 minutes to brag about my college. But it is the college that is the most racially and ethnically diverse across the colleges at UTSA, very much in line with the mission of an Hispanic-serving institution. Our graduates have also played a very important role as its community leaders. A couple of years ago, four of our graduates were among the top 40, under 40, the movers and shakers of this community that are making a difference. And we're also the third largest number of graduate students at UTSA behind the College of Education and Human Development as well as business. One of my goals as dean has been to make UTSA and the college the primary hub in our city for the discussion of important and critical public policy issues and related social, economic, demographic, and political issues. through a variety of programs such as lectures, for example, town hall forums, panels, as well as workshops, the College of Public Policy has brought together broad segments of our community to engage in key issues affecting our community. In such a manner, the College of Public Policy over the last year has collaborated on a few forums related to the important issue of water. So that we're very happy to continue this line of collaboration through the partnership with SAWS to bring together various sectors of the community to engage in discussions regarding SAWS' new proposed water project. In addition to this luncheon, there will be two other public forums, one in late September, I believe, and the other one in the spring, that'll continue this discussion and community engagement. I want to recognize a few people at UTSA then that have helped organizing this this event. Erin Gines, our development assistant, is over here. Francine Romero, who is associate dean in the College of Public Policy, is up here in front. We have a couple of our students in public policy that were personing the table out there as you came in. Eyole Mubanga, who is a master's student in public administration, and he also works in Congressman Joaquin Castro's office. We also have Gary Wade, who is a BPA graduate and is now in our MPA program. And we I'd also like to recognize our student body president, our student government association, Zach Dunn, over here, who was also in Washington this this summer. Working in the congressman's office, also Congressman Joaquin Castro. We're also very grateful to SAWS in that half of the proceeds of the $23,000, half will go to scholarships to support students in the College of Public Policy. So we're very happy about that. I would also like to thank the people who have cooked for us, who are serving us, and will be cleaning up after us, if we could give them a hand for the work that they're doing. And last but not least, I'd like to recognize elected and other officials in audience today. We know Mayor Ivy Taylor is here today. Councilman Ron Nirenberg is right here. Representative Doug Miller. Chairman Carlos Rubinstein. Okay. Robert Puente, President and CEO of SAWS. Berto Guerra, Chairman of SAWS. Pat Hasso, SAW Board Member. Reed Williams, another SAW Board Member. Okay. Ernest Arellano, SAWS Board. Commissioner Kevin Wolf. Louise Rowe, also a member of the SAWS board. Luana Buckner, EAA board chair. Okay. Ben Youngblood, EAA board. Gabriel Duran Hollis, mayor of Hill Country Village. And Representative Mike Villarreal. So now we will take a few minutes to begin eating or continue eating, and then we'll introduce the panelists. Thank you. All right, we're back. Just very brief introductions of each of our panelists. And so first of all, serving as the panel discussion here, the moderator is Evan Smith, who is the editor-in-chief and CEO of the Texas Tribune. Okay. Then our panelists, we have Carlos Rubinstein, who is the chair of the Texas Water Development Board. We have Robert Puente, who is president and CEO of SAWS. And we have Michael Beldon, who is the local business leader for Beldon Roofing, and he's the chairman of the Beldon Roofing.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Science, thank you very much. Good afternoon, everybody. Nice to be here. Always wonderful to be in San Antonio. Would prefer to always be in San Antonio, in fact, but come as often as possible. Thank you for being here, panelists. Dr. Romo, always wonderful to be with you. Thank you. We're going to just launch right in. I have the honor of being on stage with one current chairman and two former chairmen, so I'm just going to address everybody as chairman to make it simple. And Chairman Rubinstein, I thought I would begin with you, and I thought I would begin at a satellite view of the water crisis that we face in the state. Precipitates actions like the one that SAWS in the city of San Antonio are considering taking in this instance. You know, we hear all the time hyperbole about the magnitude of problems, not just on water, but on every public policy issue. And we hear specifically on the problem of water that we've just come out of, or recently come out of, the worst one-year drought in the history of the state. Back, some of us who are old enough to remember, or at least to have read about the time it never rained, this is worse, you know. Is it as bad as all that? You know, and is it continuing to be as bad as all that to the extent that this kind of significant action needs to be taken?
Well, the short answer is absolutely. We need to be taking the steps that are being contemplated here in other parts of Texas to diversify our water supplies. You're correct. We no longer have a 2011. It's kind of tough to be 2011 when you have all 254 right. counties in significant or exceptional drought conditions. So it's yep. tough to beat that. But what we're not out of is this drought. The drought is not over. We right. do not yet know if this drought will end up being the new drought of record. You go to Wichita Falls, they will tell you that they think that they already surpassed and they're already right. in a drought.
Doesn't feel any better to them.
It does not. It does not. Right. And then we look at, so it's going to rain again. Yeah. And we'll have another drought. And so where are we going to be in Texas in the following decades? Where are we going to be in 2060? You know, we plan on a 50-year horizon.
Right.
If we fail to undertake the appropriate implementation of water management strategies to meet our needs, if we fail to diversify our where our water comes from,
right.
the impact to Texas in 2060 is about $115 billion a year. The impact to Texas jobs is about 1.1 million jobs lost. The impact to Texas population is 1.4 million folks leaving.
Right.
And so, yes, we need to be doing these things.
Right. And having passed Proposition 6 last November, there are some people who don't pay attention at the detail level who think, okay, problem solved or conversation over, when in fact it really is conversation just beginning.
Absolutely. We're just getting started. And thank God the folks that showed up at the polls last November, Prop 6 passed by 73%.
Right.
But the hard work begins now. I was having a great conversation with Representative Miller about all of the variables and all of the timelines they put in House Bill 4
right.
that we're about implementing this year. And God willing, we will have all of them completed by December.
Right.
And that's when we start accepting applications, and that's when we start moving these projects forward.
Right. Now, on the same line of questioning, you are Mr. Chairman former in two instances. You're the former chairman of the Edwards Aquifer Authority, former chairman of the San Antonio Chamber, so Mr. Chairman. I want to ask you about two aspects of what Chairman Rubinstein said. First of all, the economic development aspect, or the prospects that our economic health as a state and as a region will be impacted if we fail to act in some way, this way or some other way. Then I want to ask you about the difficulty that we face right now with regard to the Edwards Aquifer specifically, which in its own way has precipitated this discussion. So talk with your former Chamber of Commerce chairman hat about the economic development predicament that we find ourselves in.
Well, nobody's going to come to San Antonio to bring a new business or build a business if we don't have an adequate water supply. I remember back when I was chair of the EAA, and the USAA, Bob Davis, threatened to move out of San Antonio because he was concerned about our future water supply.
Right.
From the chamber perspective, we've watched SAWS have water plans that have changed year to year to year to year to year. The great plans for the future did not eventuate.
Right.
My good friend and former president of the chamber, Joe Pryor, used to say, SOS will have a water plan when they put forth a plan that Tom Frost would loan the money on. And I think that is where we are today. I think we finally have a plan that makes sense, that can help San Antonio in future economic development, that's crucial to everybody in the city.
Yeah.
For all across the economic spectrum. If we don't have adequate water, it's a bad place for all of us. If we do have a great water supply, it's a wonderful place for all of us. It's a win-win.
Right, and Chairman Puente, I want to come back to on the aquifer question in a second. You understand from your years of service in public office and in the SOS capacity and just what you've observed, we find ourselves in a very interesting situation with regard to population change. Both have alluded to that. We're adding something like 1,000 or more people a day to the state's population, and as far as I know, none of those people is bringing water with him, right? So we're at risk of being victims of our own success in terms of population growth and straining what, after all, is essentially a finite resource in the course of water. That's at least part of what's at work with attempting to solve this problem, and that's not just a San Antonio problem.
What we have to address is the continued growth that we have. We want to participate in those solutions. I think in our 2012 water management plan, we have identified how to meet our needs in this region, and we look forward to reaching an agreement, potential agreement with Vista Ridge to see if we can satisfy those needs that we have out into the future.
And the growth in San Antonio is outpacing the growth in a lot of other cities, and the growth in this region similarly is outpacing the growth in a lot of other regions in the state, so it's a particular problem here.
And we at SOS have a duty to address that need, address that growth, to make sure that we are not the hindrance of the economic well-being that Mr. Beldon talks about.
Right. Chairman, the fact is that, and this now on your Edwards Aquifer Authority former chairman hat, the fact is that the Edwards Aquifer is no longer the available source for this region that it was once, in part because drought conditions and other things have impacted the ability of the aquifer to be as plentiful as we'd like it to be.
Well, I think what we all came to realization in the 93 and 95 timeframe, that this was a resource that we were going to share.
Right.
We needed to share. Because we need to share that, there are limitations on what we can fund. And I will tell you that although I've had disagreements with SOS over the years about long-term water supply, I think everybody needs to appreciate what a great job SOS has done in the ASR project, and the CRISO project, and having adequate additional water right now, at this point in time, as the EAA is moving into stage three, stage four, that SOS customers are still in stage two.
Right.
And that's because of the great work that Robert and his staff have done.
Yeah.
And so I think this is just the next step, is to put in place a really large long-term water supply. But they've done a great job in keeping us in a position today that is more favorable than most cities.
Chairman Puente, can you be specific about the reliance of SOS in this region historically on the Edwards versus where we are now and versus where we're projected to be?
Up until a few years ago, 15 years ago, we were 100% reliant on the Edwards Aquifer. So when the legislation changed in the early 1990s to where there was cutbacks, there was a certain amount of water that different stakeholders were able to withdraw from the Edwards, we were now limited. We now knew that we were not only limited when that legislation passed, there was another cutback 15 years later, which would be 2008, where another series of cutbacks had to take place. So during that 15-year period, our city, SOS, went on a mode of addressing the future. That's when we commissioned and built the ASR.
Right.
That's when we commissioned and built the largest recycle system in the nation. And that's when we started looking at other water sources, such as the Trinity, the Carrizo Aquifer. And so we've done that in the early part. Now we're getting ready again for the future. Our plans have shown that there's supply gaps in the near future, as early as 2019. So these types of projects are what is meant to meet that need to make sure we have an abundant supply of water for our community.
So we've just heard the case for action of some sort. Let's get to the specific thing that is before, or is soon to be before, we think, the city of San Antonio. SOS has previously, in fact, recently considered, in recent history, considered pipeline projects of this sort. Seemed at one moment to have pivoted away and then pivoted back to this. Can you talk a little bit about how we got here?
Our 2012 management plan identified gaps as early as 2019, and that's the worst case scenario, drought of record, all those planning numbers. In addition to the other supplies that we were looking at, we identified a gap.
Yep.
And to meet that gap, we needed about 50,000 acre feet. And we put out a proposal.
So that number has been the number all along. I know there's been some question as to where that number came from, or whether that number is too much, or whether that number is tied to this specific plan. Your contention is that number has been the number all along.
Yes.
That's the identified need.
That's the identified need. We put out a proposal with that need to be addressed. We had 9 respondents. We narrowed it down to 3, narrowed it down to eventually to 1. Our board selected for allowed us to start negotiating with the Vista Ridge Consortium, which is made up of Abengoa and Blue Water. And so they allowed us to start negotiating with them. So that 50,000 acre feet was identified. This will meet that need, but that's not exclusive to this project. To meet the need that we have, the gaps that we have to have additional water projects that we don't talk much about. One, for example, is an aquifer right here in Bexar County, the Carrizo Aquifer. Our desalination plant, which was groundbreaking, just occurred a month ago. It will be online in 2016.
Right.
And so water conservation was identified in the 2012 plan that would create at least 16,000 acre feet. So that plan was in place. So we have to have continued water conservation to meet our need, and we have to have even these other water projects to meet that need, not just this particular Vista Ridge project.
Come back to the history of how we got here in a second, but Chairman Rubinstein, this kind of any and all approach, conservation, piping in water where necessary, figuring out deals that could be made, desal, the application of technology to solve these kinds of problems, that's really, in essence, what the program that you're administering at the Water Development Board through the SWIFT and Prop 6, that's really what that's about.
Couldn't have said it any better. I do want to highlight one other thing that I think San Antonio has done exceptionally well. Let's start with the first one, conservation. Right. When you talk about conservation, what San Antonio has done since 1979, 1980, I believe the numbers reflect that you've cut the per capita consumption by 100 gallons per day per person.
Yep.
That is remarkable, and San Antonio should be applauded for that. I think you went from somewhere about 225 gallons per day per person to, I think you're in the 120 range now.
Right.
That helps, but that only addresses part of the need. The other part of the need is the raising the awareness of how we're using our water.
Right.
If you're going to conserve water to keep using it the same way you always have, you really haven't helped yourself long term. I think San Antonio does a great job in being able to raise the awareness of the value of our water. But when we look at our state water plan, and we look holistically at the entire state, trying to come up with 8.3 million acre feet of water, we look at all aspects of it. So yes, part of it can come from conservation, and it is here. Part of it can come from reuse, and it is here in San Antonio. Part of it can come from moving water from where it is to where it isn't. The water we already have today, available today, moving it from where it is to where it isn't. I guess that's part of what we're all here talking about today.
Yeah.
Part of it is also developing new sources of water. And that's when you talk about ASR, you talk about brackish, you talk about seawater.
Right.
And if you hear the discussion that's going on today, San Antonio is hitting on all of those. And I think that is very appropriate.
Chairman Puente, do I understand the history of this to be that at one point you all were so high on desal that you were considering not doing a pipeline project at all? Is that right?
Correct. At one point, we looked at expanding our current desal program. Right. Our current program has 3 stages in 5-year increments to a total of 33,000 acre feet.
Right.
That's still on the board. That's still what we're going to do. That's still in our plan. That's still what our board has appropriated money for, and that's still what our city council has given us.
But it's only a component.
It's only a component.
Right. The conspiracy theorists, and there are some on this issue, as there are on almost every issue in Texas, believe that the chamber was instrumental, the business community, in causing SAWS to pivot away from a desal-heavy plan to one that involved a big pipeline project like the one we're here to talk about today. Did you get taken to the woodshed, as one person described it to me, by the business community?
You know, just because you told me ahead of time that you were going to ask me tough questions doesn't mean that's okay to ask me tough questions.
I realize I'm a guest in your house, but I know where the door is, so it's okay. Did the business community have some impact on the way this went?
Sure. The business community, along with the environmental community, others are stakeholders in this endeavor. They have a right to say what they want to say.
Right.
But we always gave our board the options. If you look at that particular board meeting, our mayor said he wanted an abundant supply, not an adequate supply.
Right.
And so when we presented this to the board, we did recommend that they go the desal route, the expanded desal route.
Right.
But that opening was there for the board to evaluate. It was a it wasn't an issue where that particular day they needed to vote.
Yeah.
We purposely address the board, give them information, and in subsequent board meeting is when they actually vote. So during that time period, they sought further information, they received further information, and our board gave us the direction to go this other route and talk about this particular project. And the reason for that was up until this point, we were constrained by the legalities of a request for a competitive to seal proposal.
Yep.
We needed the opportunity to sit down with Abengoa and Blue Water to clarify what their proposal was. Once we were allowed to clarify that proposal, we found out that we had a lot more in common on a potential contract. So when we clarified certain issues and we informed our board, the board collectively said, this is the project that we want you to start negotiating on. And that's where we are today.
Mr. Beldon, Mr. Chairman, again, former Chamber of Commerce Chairman, you believe the business community is with SAWS in thinking that this would be good for San Antonio, not just in terms of water, but in terms of the there's an economic development aspect to this that would cause the business community, generally speaking, to be for this and may even have pushed SAWS in the direction of getting this done.
Absolutely, but I think it would be unfair to say we push SAWS, or we in the business community that lobby on these sorts of issues, that we push SAWS to do the Abengoa deal.
Yeah.
What we pushed was don't preclude it.
Look
at it. Be willing to talk about it. See if there's a deal there. You all have to decide whether the numbers work. You have to decide if there is a deal to be made. But we were very concerned that they would completely cut off and not look at the deal. And
right.
I think that's where the business community was coming from.
Okay. So explain, Chairman Puente, explain the contours of this project. So what is the overall cost of the project? What is the time frame in which the project would be executed? Kind of give us the nuts and bolts of it.
It's a 50,000 acre feet project. That's a lot of water. That would be roughly about a fourth of the supply that we have now. It would really truly diversify us, and we will have a good diversity portfolio of water.
And it's as much as you, again, going back to the original question of where that number came from, it is what you need. It is not more than you need.
Correct.
Right. So you're not going to have so much when this project is done that you're going to have to sell some of it off.
The key to that is at the beginning and in wet years, it is more than what we need.
Right. In the beginning.
And even today, when we have a series of wet years, we have more than what we need.
Right.
And we never want, obviously, to have less than what we need.
Right.
So ideally, the first part of this project, we will look at partners up and down that corridor from here to Burleson County. It's a very high-growth corridor, Highway 130. And look at all those communities. And we're currently talking to a lot of those communities about potential partnerships where they would buy part of this water for their own needs.
Yep.
And so this will help drive down the cost. This will help any rate increase that we may need from city council that our ratepayers would have to pay for. It will help in that endeavor. So it's hard to say exactly what it will cost, but we do know that it's an expensive project.
Yep.
Any project-
Ballpark, and I know hard to say is truthful and sincere, but just for fun, ballpark it.
Ballpark, it's about a $3 billion project.
Right. Can you also ballpark what the potential rate increase for ratepayers is going to be?
Remember, this is a very big ballpark, Major League ballpark.
I've been to big Major League ballparks. They're not infinite sized, so I know it may be big, but ballpark it nonetheless.
And they have very low fences to where you could actually hit a home run. So it's roughly, we're talking about 16% rate increase.
16%.
Yes. Our goal is to drive that number down through a lot of mechanisms. One is the partnerships that we talked about.
Right.
Another one is negotiations are currently undergoing where there's an issue of the O&M cost. Power is very important. Water is very heavy. We have probably four different electrical providers along this route, one of them being CPS Energy. We want to negotiate with CPS to give us very favorable rates, but also have these other entities use CPS as the power provider and trade power with them to where their rates that they charge us are actually CPS rates.
And you'll pass any proceeds of sale of water in those early years or any of the other deals that you cut with the partners you're referring to, that will be passed on down the line to ratepayers.
Exactly.
So that the 16% is kind of an outbound prediction of what the rate increase may be, but ideally you'd like it to be less.
Sure. And the power cost, whatever dollar we pay, we know 14% goes back to our city
Mr. Chairman, if I understand, again, I'm not an expert in San Antonio politics, which is as complicated as it is in any city, but as I understand it, the council has to approve a rate increase, correct?
They own SAWS. The city of San Antonio owns SAWS. Our ratepayers own SAWS, so yes.
What guarantee do you have, if this deal is done, that the city council, as the ones who have to approve rate increases, would approve rate increases?
I think the council, as they have done previously, in particular the 6 years that I've been there, as long as SAWS does the ground root support, they do the outreach, they go into the communities, they talk to their constituents,
right.
they tell them the reasons why we need this rate increase, like we did a few years ago for our consent decree with EPA regarding our sewer system, that they'll see the support, that their own constituents, our own ratepayers, will support it, and then they feel comfortable supporting it.
You're not concerned about the uncertainty of a council at some point in the future that may be a council with different people on it than the council we're talking about today. You don't see the uncertainty of the council having to approve a rate increase as a potential hurdle to get over.
As a former political person, I understand the difficulties of it, but I understand that that's the reason we run for office, is to make hard decisions. Right. If it was easy, a lot of more people would be doing it. So we will give the council the information that they need to feel very confident that what the decisions that they make are the good for this community.
I want to ask Chairman Puente and Chairman Beldon as well, who's making money on this deal? Somebody has to be making money on the construction of this pipeline. Who's making money on this deal?
Well, anybody associated with Abengoa and Blue Water making money. There's nothing wrong with making money. It's our free enterprise system, capitalism, are what makes this world go.
Right.
It's what makes the United States go, what makes San Antonio go. So different engineering firms, it is their business to acquire work and get work, and they happen to employ a lot of San Antonians, so they'll make money. Construction companies, steel manufacturers, people that service the pipeline, they will all make money. There will be investors that make money. There's nothing wrong, and we recognize that at SAWS, that there's nothing wrong with, because we are reaching an agreement with a private entity.
Yeah.
Private entities need to make money. They should make money. We recognize that. They deserve a rate of return that will be attractive to their investors.
Right.
Because we are buying a product, and there's nothing wrong with buying a product.
Surely you agree with that, right? This is a...
Robert said he used to be in politics. I got news for you.
Still in politics? It's like riding a bike, you know? You never lose it.
So in addition, there's 3,400, I believe, water rights holders that are also going to make money off this.
Right.
But there's nothing wrong with making money. I think you need to put this in perspective, and let's look historically.
Yeah.
If we had bought water in the 70s or 80s, it would have ranged from $30 to $40 an acre foot. Today, we're talking north of $2,000 an acre foot.
Right.
Do we want to be 20 years from today, have people look back when water now is $5,000 an acre foot? Pick a number. The only thing we know for sure is it's going to be more.
Yeah.
We want to have people come back and say, what were those guys thinking when they had an opportunity to get 50,000 acre feet of water and they didn't do it?
Mm-hmm. So in terms of the economics of this, the question that I've been asked and that I feel duty-bound to ask you is, is everybody who stands to make a buck off of this thing public? I've been a critic of this project said to me, well, why won't SAWS release the list, or why won't the people behind this release the list of investors in the project? I know you all have talked about, and others have talked about, how transparent this project has been as it's come together. Have you released, or would you release, the list of investors?
They have released a list of their investors, and they went even beyond what is required under our city ordinance to release those investors.
So you're satisfied that there's been adequate transparency?
Yes.
Chairman Rubinstein, let me ask you about groundwater law. I mean, obviously, a lot of the success of this project hinges on the ability of sort of the need to intersect properly with what the law is and available resources and everything else. Back in February, Chairman Puente was quoted in the Texas Tribune. You may have heard of it.
Once or twice.
As saying the following, quote, groundwater law in Texas leaves too much uncertainty and risk for the private and public sectors. Was he right then that groundwater law at present is risky, and so risky that taking on a project such as this might itself be too risky?
You know, groundwater law in Texas is what it is. And I think when you find a way to work within the constraints of you could say the same for surface water as well.
Yeah, sure.
You know, so you can make that argument for wherever you want to go. I think in this instance, when I look at the information that's been made public, when you appropriately work with a groundwater conservation district, as it appears that that has occurred,
yeah.
When you appear to be able to satisfy the water right holders, the area, the folks that own that land in that area, then I think you find a way to move things forward. I think there's innovation to be had. There is a reason why in Texas groundwater law is what it is. The preferred method in Texas of dealing with groundwater is at the local level.
Right.
And we do so by establishing groundwater conservation districts. We don't have them everywhere in Texas, but we have just around 100 of them around. And when you're able to work with them, when you're able to work with the science that exists, the desired future condition, what is it that that aquifer is going to look like? How much water do you have available to permit so that you're also protecting future interests as well? I think you can get to a point where you can collaboratively also work through these obstacles that are there. But you could say the same for surface water. If you want to go and attract surface water, how much water is available? What reliability do you have? And then you can quantify all of those as challenges to overcome.
Right.
It's just part of what we have to deal with.
Chairman Puente, what changed between February and now that back then you were expressing concern publicly about the risk that groundwater law would pose for a project of this sort, but not today?
What changed were those clarification talks we had with Abengoa and Blue Water Vista Ridge. And essentially, you talked about profit, who's making a profit. One of the reasons why they should make a profit is because what we've agreed to is that they will take that risk.
So the risk is actually with them.
The risk of groundwater changes, state law changes, they will have to be burdened with that risk.
Right.
And because they are, part of the reason they are able to is to take on that risk is that they will be able to get a rate of return that is sufficient to meet that risk.
And there's no change. I know Representative Miller is here. Representative Virial apparently is going to be otherwise occupied next year, not in the legislature, but Representative Miller at least will be here. Is there anything that he and his colleagues up the road should be thinking about that you'd like them to be thinking about in terms of changes to groundwater law as they would affect this project or other projects?
The quote you said, I still stand by.
Right.
We were able to negotiate that away in this particular project.
Right.
But that is true for every other project that we undergo and that the rest of the state undergoes. We still have very difficult groundwater district rules and state law that does not help projects to
get
off
the ground. So you'd like some sort of changes, but not only for this project, generally?
Yes. For example, our brackish desal plant that we are currently building, we are spending money on, could benefit from regulatory changes, state law changes.
Yep.
Our expansion could benefit from it. And other parts of the state are looking at brackish, and they should benefit also from those changes.
Okay. Let me move on to Chairman Rubinstein and ask about the nature of groundwater supplies and the particular situation we have with geography. So this project, Chairman Puente, I understand is a Burleson County. This is a Burleson County deal. As I understand it, the adjacent counties are Lee and Bastrop County. And there is a big fight going on right now over access to groundwater. I believe there are two active bits of litigation over groundwater in Lee and Bastrop counties, 45,000 acre feet at issue. What is to say that the resolution of the way this works is basically that water knows no county lines, right? You have one county, you have another county, but the fact is, which water, where does it go, kind of how does this all work? If the Lee and Bastrop County lawsuit, this is the Lost Pines groundwater conservation, if that is resolved in a way in which water is withdrawn, is that going to in any way impact the available resources at Burleson County in the Post Oak Savannah groundwater conservation district, proximity being what it is?
In a simplistic way, I think, you know, the way we do water availability in Texas accommodates for those potential changes. We need to revisit desired future conditions consistent with when we're revisiting the state water plan. All of those things firm up how much water we have available. There's a couple of things that we already know. For example, by 2012 in Texas, just because of the way, by 2060 in Texas from the 2012 plan, we know there's going to be 10% less water. That's already built into the planning that is occurring statewide. when you have a process where you revisit desired future conditions, when you have a process where you revisit and true up managed available water that's available for permitting, I think you're able to catch up, and it's a dynamic process right. that we follow.
So the thinking behind this project takes into account the possibility that a nearby repository of groundwater might suddenly see 45,000 acre feet withdrawn. It doesn't necessarily impact the calculation made about the available resources for this project.
And the responsibility for determining the availability of that water still rests at the local level with yep. that groundwater conservation district.
Right. I read the Express News Chairman Puente within the last couple of days. In fact, I think it was yesterday there was a story about this project. And I was struck by this statement related to the Post Oak Savannah Groundwater Conservation District, from which you seek 50,000 acre feet of water for this project. It's modeled, this is referring to mm-hmm. the resource that you're going to be taking from. It's modeled available groundwater is 61,020 acre feet annually. Now, I'm a simple-minded person when it comes to this stuff, so I may be doing the math wrong, or I may be reading that in a way that's not sophisticated enough, but taking 50,000 acre feet from a repository that is said by the Express News to have 61,000 or so of modeled available groundwater annually, that sounds like a lot of water coming out of a limited pool of water. Help me understand how that all works.
There is that number, but this, again, these are conservative numbers. This is a groundwater district that has a very different philosophy than most groundwater districts. They recognize that there's a need for water and yep. that the exportation of that water can be very beneficial to their own economy, their own well-being. So they, for example, are one of the only groundwater districts that give out permits for even more than 5 years.
Yep.
They actually have 30 and 35-year permits, because you need two different permits, a permit to get the water out of the ground and a permit to move it out of the county. They, Vista Ridge Project already has permits for both. And so that philosophy of that groundwater district and those numbers you talked about are very conservative numbers, so we feel very confident that the 50,000 acre feet is a firm number. Part of this negotiation, Abengoa has also, Vista Ridge has also agreed that if for example, they have more than 50,000 acre feet of land leased,
yeah.
they have enough for a buffer in case that there is some kind of drawdown
right.
or there's some kind of regulatory change by the groundwater district. So again, our proposal was 50,000 firm acre feet of water, not drought, not subject to drought,
right.
firm. And so their response to this proposal was firm 50,000 acre feet. And so those issues were addressed during the proposal.
You're confident that that's
yes.
not. And this is the Carrizo-Wilcox
Correct.
Aquifer. So you know something, Chairman Beldon, about aquifers, having chaired the Edwards Aquifer Authority. Do those numbers concern you in terms of the water that would be withdrawn and available resources and long-term health of the local communities from which this water would suddenly be transported?
The last thing I would claim to be is a technical water guy.
Right.
But from everything I know, I'm confident that they have, that Abengoa and Blue Water have enough water
yep.
that they can meet this need. And San Antonio is only going to pay for delivered water.
Well, so let's come to that specifically. So the phrase that I've heard is take and pay, which sounds, you know, kind of great. I like that. So if you take it, you pay for it. But if you don't get it, you don't pay for it. Right. That's how that goes. So that's another case of the vendor in this instance bearing risk. Could you talk about how that works?
Oftentimes, when a project is built, no matter what happens, someone has to pay for that project.
Yeah.
Whether it's a drought condition or anything like that. In this particular proposal, the contract negotiations that we're undergoing, we have agreed that if they don't deliver the water, we don't pay for anything. And so that risk is on them. They, for example, if for whatever reason upstream from our meter, from our gate, they cannot deliver that water, they still have to make their bond payments. They still have to pay for this project.
Yeah, yeah.
But we don't have to pay for
the
water.
You're not on the hook for that stuff, Correct. As it turns out.
But the risk we take is if they do deliver the water, regardless of our situation, we have to pay for that water. So if it's a series of wet years, we take that risk. We have to dispose of that water through our distribution system to our customers.
Chairman.
But doesn't that also make the exact case for why it's so wise for San Antonio, for example, to be diversifying and looking into multiple sources to be able to overcome
right.
wherever a potential shortage may materialize from any one given source?
Right. In the event that things don't work
exactly.
out, you've got multiple options that you can draw on.
And currently, those things don't work out. So currently, we do have, for example, some surface water that we had that had water quality issues, and we turned that off. Our surface water supply, Medina Lake, doesn't exist anymore. We had to turn that off.
Right, that's down to, that's at zero.
That's at zero. So that diversity that we have of the Trinity Aquifer, the Carrizo Aquifer, and the management, not just the Edwards water, but the management of the Edwards water, means that we can meet the demands of our customers.
Right. Let me ask one more big question that we'll get each of you to talk about, and then maybe we'll throw it open for questions from the audience. And I think we're supposed to have microphones on either side. We'll ask you to line up, and we'll take as many questions as time permits today. Chairman Rubinstein, Chairman Puente both talked about conservation. That is now, among other things, that is San Antonio's brand, right? We're the community that really got it right or has gotten it right on conservation and has seen a significant savings of our water use. How will this sudden, plentiful, abundant availability of water impact the city's psyche as it gets to conservation? So it's easy to persuade people to do things in a crisis. It's harder to get people to do things if they think, well, we got 50,000 acre feet, we can all water our lawns every day 10 times. We have all this water, everything's great. So the city is gonna hear in the course of this project working its way through, well, we've got all this additional water available to us. Why would anybody at that point feel like we're in enough of a crisis situation that the kind of good stewardship of our resources and conservation that we've done would still be necessary going forward, Chairman?
Again, in 2011, when we started developing our 2012 water management plan, we had new 2010 census numbers. We had the integration of the Barometz system that was very water poor. So the plan that we developed identified this gap, identified the need for this 50,000 acre feet, but still identified the need to continue the water conservation programs that we have and even to expound on them, to make them more aggressive, to drive down that per capita use.
Right.
And so our goal is still to drive down that goal, to meet the needs that we have in the future. It's not only a big expensive project like this, it's that day-to-day water conservation that we're very good at. We have to continue to drive that down to our customers, that we still need them to use water very wisely. And so this concept that we're drawing away from water conservation, that we will lose that ethic, is just not there. To meet the goals, we need to have 16,000 acre feet of water conserved from the 2012 plan into the future.
And that's not going to be a passive messaging of conservation. No. It's actually going to be an active messaging on the part of
yes.
it. Talk to me, Mr. Beldon, Chairman, on the business community end of this.
So I think that San Antonio has that culture.
Yeah.
And let me contrast that for a moment. I recently heard a speaker from California talk about the nexus of water and energy. And she said something that was absolutely astounding to me. The city of Sacramento, until recently, had no water metering. Flat rate for water.
Yep.
That is so alien to our culture in San Antonio. I, for one, think that we have the best leadership we've ever had in the water arena.
Yep.
I have confidence that our city council is as good a council as the city has ever seen.
Yep.
They're not going to get stupid all of a sudden and let us go away from what we've done so well with.
Right.
You either have confidence in your leadership, which I have a great deal of confidence in, or you don't.
Or you don't.
And I believe that they have the foresight and the understanding and the intelligence to continue to do those things that have worked well for us.
Yep.
And so I'm not the least bit worried about the concern.
Let the record show that it took 45 minutes for somebody to beat up on California, which in Texas, in a public policy conversation in Texas, may be a new record. Chairman, last word to you on conservation.
Well, you hadn't opened up the door on being able
I hadn't,
to
be, that's
so
true,
that's
I know.
Part of the problem.
I wasn't doing my job.
Now, And Chairman Puente has heard me say this before. He and I gave a presentation 3 years ago in Schertz, and there was a slide in his presentation. So, and what the point I'm making is the history for San Antonio absolutely supports the fact that conservation will remain. There's a slide in Chairman Puente's presentation that showed, and I think it was since 1980, the population growth, 62% population growth, if I'm remembering correctly.
Correct.
Still dealing with the same amount of water. The psyche's already built in.
Yeah.
The rate structure that San Antonio has already put in place is built in. The comment that I made to you earlier, You don't get San Antonio from going from 225 gallons per capita per day to 125 just because it was dry. In that period of time, we had periods of flood and periods of plenty.
Yeah.
And yet, it is a marked record of being able to reduce that consumptive rate, which indicates to me that people understand that it isn't to conserve water just so when we have it, we're going to continue to use it the same way. It's to conserve water because, one, it's the cheapest water we will have.
Right.
But we learn the value of it. And I think that that clearly is going on here. Good. And I think it's sustainable.
Okay, well, let me ask that anybody in the audience who has questions, we have the two microphones, and so for the benefit of people in the audience who would like to hear your questions, we'll ask you to stand at the microphones, and I'll go one, the other, until we run out of time. I think we have a few minutes. Sir, okay. You were fastest to your feet, so go ahead.
Well, first of all, I want to thank the panel for a superb job, and I do realize this is a Vista Ridge sauce topic, but since we have a new leader at our Texas Water Development Board, and he's here in San Antonio, and our new leader has $2 billion fall on his head. You know, I'd really like to hear from you, Chairman, about what are we gonna see happen in Texas? How are you gonna effectively manage this? What are your gonna be priorities? Because you listed a bunch of ways to approach the water. How can you quickly turn over this money? Because it's not grants, it's loans, but so we can use it and reuse it, but it's a tremendous opportunity, and I'd love to hear what your thoughts are.
And let's be clear, Chairman, before you start, that the SWIFT money that's available as a consequence of Prop 6 actually does not intersect with this project specifically, right? So it is not the case that you're administering a fund that will in part go to support this project.
Well, right now, I don't believe that that is contemplated. But we could support projects like this. There's a lot of things about the project that would play well in future projects or similar projects. If you build a project, you have extra capacity in the early years, and you end up enhancing regionalization. House Bill 4 speaks to that.
Yep.
And we're supposed to give high priority to projects like that. And so those are things that are of interest to me, and I hope that we see those going forward. To your question, and I hope you appreciate that by asking that question, you could tee me off for another hour discussion. So I hope you all have some time. Yeah. The $2 billion has been transferred, the day, you know, shortly after Texans by 73%. Approved to Prop 6. The $2 billion is being managed by the Texas Safekeeping Trust. It is a function of the State Comptroller's Office. So while the money is dedicated for the Water Development Board, I wish I could tell you that I saw it for like a microsecond. I didn't. It's all at the Safekeeping Trust. The trust is already investing in it. It's already making money. How are we going to use it? It's very specific. How are we going to decide how the money is going to be utilized? Well, we're going to hear from you all. House Bill 4 is very specific about how the projects are to be picked. House Bill 4 did not change the bottom-up approach on prioritizing what a local area wants to do to meet its future demands for water. So we are waiting for the regional planning groups to finalize their final prioritization list by statute that is required by September 1st of this year. I want to tell you that there hasn't been a single deadline that was established in House before that hasn't been met. We established, working with the regional planning groups, a uniform set of standards to prioritize projects at the regional level and did that early. The regional planning groups were required to submit their draft lists by June 1st. They did that, every single one of them, all 16, without exception. Some of them, in reading updates that I get from all of the regional planning groups, have already voted on submitting their final prioritized list that is due in September. They're voting on that right now.
Yep.
And so I'm very confident that all those lists will be finalized September 1. House Bill 4 also established a tremendous amount of oversight, which I welcome. We get to report to an advisory committee made up of 3 members of the House, 3 members of the Senate, and somebody from the Comptroller's Office on how we're investing the fund, how we're doing the rules. We've already met with those members. We're also meeting with all of the elected officials that we can on what it is that we're doing. But the other thing that we're doing is, and I hope you all have seen it, the board has really taken on outreach, just like the transparency that you spoke about earlier, to make sure that we get buy-in and understanding of what people's ideas are on how we should implement the rules. House Bill 4 requires that before we can cut the first check, the Water Development Board has to construct a set of rules and adopt them. They have to be adopted by March of next year. I promise you we have no interest in having that rule open till March of next year. Right now we're on a path to having that rule adopted and final by December of this year, which means that we will be able to, from the list that the regional planning groups have prioritized, accept applications for funding this time next year. How quickly are we going to be able to do it? We have run a tremendous amount, countless amount of stress tests on the model to determine the capacity of how we're going to turn $2 billion to $27 billion over 50 years. Right now, we know that when we open up the first round of applications, we will be able to accept applications up to $800 million a year for the first few years, a little over $8 billion in applications in the first decade. Think about that. The 2012 plan says that to implement all the water management strategies that are there, it's going to cost us $53 billion over 50 years. We're on a path to be able potentially to fund a third of that in the first decade alone.
Right.
So I think it bodes very, very well. Clearly, when applications come to us, House Bill 4 also requires that we apply a different set of criteria to prioritize those as well. Among the things that we'll be looking for is what size of population is this serving? Does it also protect rural Texas? And rural Texas is protected because you can have a small project that per capita or percentage-wise supplies a tremendous amount of water for that area. We'll be able to protect rural Texas as well.
And is there a percentage in the deal that has to go to rural or ag? Is that right?
There is. There are very specific set-asides in House Bill 4. The legislature told us very directly what their vision was.
Right.
The actual wording in the bill is somewhere along the lines that the Water Development Board will undertake to utilize not less than 20% of the fund for conservation and reuse. It also says that the Water Development Board has to undertake the utilization of not less than 10% of the fund for rural and agricultural interests. Chairman Puente knows when you include words in statute that says undertake the utilization of not less than, that is a floor and not a ceiling. And so we'll be looking for the regional planning groups to identify those projects, bring them forward, and help us identify them. So I hope that is at least responsive to the question that was
asked. And on the question of, I'll come to your question in one second, I promise, ma'am. On the question of buy-in, Chairman Puente, the city of San Antonio understands that projects that seem like slam dunks when they don't have adequate buy-in from the public tend to go away. How are you going to avoid this falling into the same trap that some others have fallen into?
By the outreach that we do.
Yeah.
This is an example, but the real examples that we have to give our council is asking council members, who in your district should we meet with?
Right.
You set up the meeting, we will go to it, we'll explain this project to them. We're asking our advisory boards and our board members to participate in that. So it's
retail
a matter,
politics.
Yes, it's a matter of that outreach.
Got it, ma'am.
Good afternoon. Is this on?
I can repeat your question if it's not.
Okay. Well, I have a comment and a question. I live near Medina Puddle. It used to be Medina Lake. The forests outside San Antonio are dying from the current drought. On our property, we are currently cutting down 30 to 40 foot trees because they're dead. This proposal is very exciting to hear about, and I think it's much better than previous proposals over the past 20 years that I've heard about. So my question is, and you may have partially answered this for me, I didn't hear rainwater capture as a factor in the complex equation of water conservation and water use. Will there be any state or regional incentives for commercial and residential builders to include rainwater capture and use in construction and remodels?
Mr. Beldon, actually, we're sort of walking up to your business. What do you think about that?
Well, I think there's a great opportunity there. We're in the roofing business. We're also in the gutter business in 14 cities across the country. And we sell a lot of rain barrels.
Yeah.
So there's no question that there's a lot that can be done in that arena.
There's a place for you all to have a role. Mr. Chairman Puente, do you see that as a component of this?
Yes. When I was in the legislature, I passed a couple of water rain harvesting bills. We do recognize that there's limitations as far as a public utility is concerned regarding that. Because first of all, it has to rain to capture that water. And also, it's for outdoor use.
Right.
We're very protective of the indoor use, the cross-contamination that could potentially happen. But as far as the items that you talked about or the incentives that you talked about, I think those are great ideas.
Yeah.
And things that we're looking at and hopefully participate in.
I see another chairman looming. So we may be, it may be that our time has come to an end here. I appreciate the questions. I want to appreciate, say much how much I appreciate the panelists' willingness to answer the questions and to engage in a serious conversation. Please give them a hand. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, and good afternoon, everyone. I want to thank, for those of you that don't know me, I'm Berto Guerra, chairman of SAWS. I want to thank Mayor Taylor and Councilman Nierenberg for being here and whatever other council members are here that I have not recognized. But thank you for being here today. Dr. Romo and Dr. Sines, thank you for helping us with this endeavor. To my good friend, Representative Mike Villarreal, thank you for being here and caring today. We appreciate you. And Representative Doug Miller, who I just met today, thank you for being here, Representative Miller. To Chairman Carlos Rubinstein and Robert Puente and my friend Mike Beldon and Evan Smith for all the great questions and answers that we went through. And to NOWCastSA, who has live streamed to the public, sponsored by CPS, these issues. There has never been, in my very humble opinion, a more important topic that we as citizens can discuss. 36 years ago, I was a member of the Hispanic Chamber in Austin, Texas, and I admired this city from afar because we in Austin would get together and we'd go to Washington, D.C. to try to save Bergstrom and to try to bring things to our city. And we would get to Washington, D.C. to find African-Americans, Latinos, Anglo-Americans, Asian-Americans, Republicans and Democrats, arm in arm from San Antonio, visiting our state capital, our nation's capital, and our state capital, getting things done for San Antonio. I had never seen anything like that in my life. The one thing that I did not admire San Antonio for was, why in the world weren't you diversifying your water supply? That bothered me. And I had nothing to do with water other than washing my car and taking a shower and drinking some water. But I thought it was important for a city. And so 20 years ago, my wife and our four kids moved here. And we now have 10 grandkids that live here. And I could no longer complain about why weren't we diversifying our water supply. It was time to put a team together to do just that. And I asked former Councilman Reed Williams to join me and Robert Puente in that effort. We asked our staff to get behind us. We asked our city council one by one to be courageous, to step up to the plate, and that we would step up to the plate with them so that we could diversify our water supply. And in answer to your first question, I will tell you this. Yes, we decided to go desal, but only because at that time, the price was too high. And as Board of Trustees, we have a fiduciary responsibility to you for how much we're going to pay for the water. Is it going to be a fixed price? Are we going to get the pipeline at the end of 30 years? Not pay for it, but we're already paying for it along the way, so we're going to get it. Is it going to be a way to grow our economy? You grow your economy, it creates jobs. And one thing we didn't mention in today's talk was affordability. We have not forgotten about the poor people that need to have affordable water. Another thing we did not mention was building over the aquifer. And by that I mean responsible building over the aquifer. We've always, as citizens, been very responsible there. So I stand before you today as chairman of SAWS, a volunteer job, to ask for your help. It's going to take every single one of us in this community to make this happen and to secure our future for our children and our grandchildren. I told the city council in executive session that maybe today people won't appreciate your vote, and 20 years from now, nobody will remember who did it. But 20 years from now, when water could be, who knows, you name a price, like Mike Beldon said, I'm going to save $15,000 an acre foot just to scare you. Somebody will say, someone way back 20 years ago had the courage and had the vision to do what was right. So I want to thank each and every one of you for being here, our panelists. Evan Smith for asking very good questions. Dr. Romo, Dr. Sines, and all of you who participated today for caring. And we're going to ask for your help. Have a great afternoon. Thank you.